Josh, did you have kind of a quick summary of our last meeting that we might look at? Or where did you want to start?
I kind of yeah, I do have a bit of a summary. Just kind of essentially, it's the last the presentation, the first. I condensed it a little bit, but the slides from the last presentation, just as a refresher, are the first set of slides, and then we can enter into a discussion, kind of, revisiting some of the topics discussed, because there was, what was presented was the framework and for that data-driven exercise, but there was also a discussion about, how we can get more qualitative component in, and
Right.
so I want to make sure we have space for that. And then the idea is looking at those goals and what are some of those kind of available data sets that could be used if we choose to go in that direction. What would that start to look like? So I guess with that, Crystal, I'm able to, there we are, progress the slides. Does that sound like a decent strategy, Tom?
It does to me.
Okay, because it was what, almost 4 weeks ago, so I had to rewatched it last night to remember what we all talked about. And it looks like we do have some of the participants from last time, and then also Jose with one of the jurisdictions here. So not as much representation from the jurisdictions as last time, but thanks for being here, Jose. So with that, just a bit of an overview. We looked at that ADOT framework and the RMAP framework. It's kind of the state of the practice of looking at data-driven, performance-based planning and programming. And the discussion towards the end of the last meeting was really, there's multiple members expressing interest in getting, well, how can we have a tool that helps us look at outcomes of the project? What's that impact of that project? And just kind of a reminder of the state of the practice, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but ADOT, FAG, City of Tucson, our colleagues up in Phoenix, MAG, were using this, the consultants that they brought on to catch up with where we were 3 years ahead of them. Their consultants have done it six different regions across the country. This is the state of the practice for this kind of stage of project level assessment for data-driven exercise. And the outcomes are more geared towards what is the potential for impacting your goals and impacting your performance, as opposed to the explicit impact that you're going to see. So I know that's not what, I know there is an expectation of more being able to better articulate what that impact is going to be, but we're going to have to kind of, it's kind of this, that's kind of where we are. So touched on ADOT and our exercise. Patrick Hartley was able to touch on how the city did it. And again, Patrick helped me build this when he was here. Then he went over to the city and kind of rebuilt it with the different, with some tweaks to the data sets. And
hey, Josh,
yes.
Why don't you give us just a really quick and dirty example of the difference between a predicted impact versus measured actual impact, just in,
The best
you
one I
know,
can
just
think
one good
of
example.
is safety related. So we have in our platform, we have that red, yellow, green, red, where level of safety service four is the poorest performing level of safety service on our network. And we have that delineated for a large swath of the major facilities in our network and all of the signalized intersections. that allows us to see, hey, if you want to have an impact on safety, go to where you're seeing poor levels of safety performance, like class 3 or class 4, level 3 or level 4. And putting money on those projects with the intent of safety in mind, it's going to be better spent than putting money on, if you're trying to address safety issues, on a level 1 or a level 2. You can put money, you can put safety improvements in that area, but that area of the network isn't as poorly performing as level 3 or level 4. So that is a little, that's kind of the stage that we're in. The next stage of getting to more explicit outcomes is requires more detail of what your investment's going to be, what are the safety issues for that level 3. Say okay, where there's smoke, there's fire. Let's look at the 3 and 4 areas. What are we going to do about it? What are the type of safety? What is the crash history in this area? What are potentially the geometry issues with that roadway? What are the lighting issues with that roadway? What are some of the characteristics of the facility type and the incidents? And with those two pieces of information, you can look at the crash modification factor clearinghouse and say, given these characteristics of incidents and these characteristics of the facility type, if you apply a median in a facility that doesn't have a median, for instance, that is going to reduce the relevant crashes by X amount, by 73% or 23% or whatever the crash modification factor is. So we're not at that stage of applying that crash modification factor. We're at the stage of, let's focus on areas of the network that appear to be poorly performing. And through the design of the project, we're gonna get to a more explicit calculation of that return of that BC, that benefit cost ratio. Tom, was that, I see some hands up, but was that good enough an example?
Yeah, I think that's the point I wanted to make sure everybody kind of understood, that if you want to address, if you want to impact safety, then you want to look at the areas where historically we've had the greatest impact, and that is the ones that are the poorest performing. And I think it's kind of the same with all the different metrics that we use, identifying those areas where we can get the most bang for our buck. Ava, did you have a question?
Yes, thank you. I wanted to know, what are factors or characteristics that are currently found at some of our most poorest performing crash zones?
That's a different presentation. Rick, if you wouldn't mind, so we're looking at that. And so there is a current call for projects for federal safety funds, HSIP funds, and we have an entirely different platform that digs in really deep on the 5-year crash safety history, those facility characteristics, taking those incidents and relating to them. So some of the things that we're seeing is an increase in that, the vulnerable users. So the bike and ped crashes are getting disproportionately affected with respect to the volume of bike ped users on the network, right? That is not new. That is something that our region suffers from on account of our post-World War II development pattern. And, so that's something that we're grappling with. It's also a condition of changing vehicle types, reduction in enforcement on account of COVID and post. And I really hope I'm not coming across making excuses, but there's a lot of factors that come into behavioral issues with it. And so portions of it are.
Right. But my question is, what are the characteristics, right? Like, what are the built characteristics?
Sure. So intersections. Intersections are something that's a concern, right? Mid-block crossings, poorly lit areas. As we look at these, so not having refuge. So a lot of.
Josh, I can jump in. Yeah. I think if I'm understanding where you're going from, so typically where Josh is going on intersections, there's always a component in there that's focused on the built portion of it, as well as the behavioral aspect. We have a human interaction that we know we always have to be aware of. So intersections where you may have driveways too close to the intersection, you may have very big intersections, you may have transit stops not properly or most effectively located, which facilitate people crossing away from where the marked crosswalks are. We may have mid-block crossing areas with high demand generators. We look at, can we facilitate and improve that with lighting or even dedicated hot crossings? So things that would be more conducive, or where there's a lot of conflicting movements, where basically where a lot of people are trying to do similar things, but interfacing with each other in an unhealthy way. Driveways too close, crossings where you don't, people trying to turn short of an intersection, you need a median to help kind of channel that. Pedestrians that are crossing outside of the marked areas or the designated areas, bicyclist, bus, transit, or vehicles turning, all having to share the same space. So that kind of give you an indicator of some of those things that would identify or be characteristics of a high concern, high risk, high potential area.
I think you're also looking at the types of accidents. So you look at your crash history and see you have in an intersection, you may typically find a lot of rear end collisions, and those may be impacted by right turning movements, by, you know, other types of conflicts that that jump up. They typically happen when you put in a new signal. You get rid of maybe a lot of the head-on collisions, but you end up with rear-end collisions. But those are among the many things that jurisdictions look at when they try to assess when they have a 3 or a 4 level of safety service. Brian, you have a question.
Yeah, thank you, Tom. So just to clarify, I try to think of the projects that maybe were being done in the current RTA and how they've improved and how we score these. So for me, what comes to mind would be like Silverbell Road, for example. Everything was just redone under current up to, I believe it's score A or just above. But past that, up to Ina, it's still that winding, two lane, not divided median, no bike lanes, no sidewalks or anything like that. And so when these projects come up, the intention is, because having lived in this area and worked in that area, you know, I understand the dangers of what that Silverbell Road stretch looks like. But when we look at it and maybe we go to a divided, a median divided roadway where we're adding bike lanes and we're adding sidewalks. And I know there's no transit in that area right now, but also creating the bus pull outs. I mean, those are all the things that are considered when we're looking at a roadway's current condition and then what those safety metrics are that can improve the safety. Is that accurate?
I think that's a great way of saying it, Brian. And another way of saying it is on a reconstruct project or something of that size and magnitude, there's applications of, you know, the universal best practices, a dedicated bike and pedestrian facility rather than sharing it with a lane, and dedicated turning lanes instead of trying to have those interfere with the through lane. So those are a conglomeration of putting those renowned, known, and established best practices, design standards, all those things, and saying we're going to apply those so that we can upgrade the overall facility and its aspects of it.
And one thing I'd also like to kind of point out, the safety, like as you look at the projects in the portal, you'll see that safety really kind of is glowing red, particularly with the, and to me that's a good sign, because that shows that there's consistent commitment across our partners to be focusing on safety issues, because they all, it's a tough issue to try to deal with when you continue to see the numbers go up. Sorry. Whoa. Didn't expect that to happen. And in particular, you know, of the city projects, you know, that, and this kind of gets to some of the other comments that were made last time. We may need to be thinking about, you know, what are those groupings, and Tom touched on it on Monday with the project types that Rick had kind of prepared, and we had discussed, you know, with, you know, some of them are Kevin mentioned this last time, you know, the new roadway projects. Maybe we have a different set of categories for those, right? You know, because those aren't really going to show up on the safety stuff. But that doesn't mean that the jurisdiction sponsors that submitted those new roadway projects aren't also interested in the safety concerns in their region, or, you know, in their jurisdiction. So where the cities, and you guys haven't had the opportunity to hear this, but, you know, the cities' submittals were prioritized on their exercise, which focused on safety and equity. So when you look in our portal, they actually had a little bit of a different slice on how they looked at safety data, same foundational data. But when you look at how the city's projects perform in our portal, they're all poorly performing in safety. Congestion isn't so bad on the project that they submitted for the most part, but safety is glowing red, and that is the case. So I feel so as if
my,
our method you, gets there.
Thank you so much for, you know, for helping me to understand some of these issues. You know, as a citizen, you know, as a part of this committee, I've seen a lot of projects that I'm concerned about, right? We've completed projects or are in the process of completing projects that I feel have created intersections that are so massive, yeah, that I'm concerned about what they're doing to the safety of non-motorized people, you know? So that's something that I feel like I'm going to have to sell with this package, right? And right. I want to know how I can do that.
So, and this is a thing that chimed in. Thanks for sharing that, right? I mean, like, I get it, because that last statement, you're going to have to sell. And like, we want you comfortable and like solid in selling this, right? Like, I have to sell it too, right? And to my friends and my, you know, my circles and one thing, one thing that is rather innovative with our RTA program, our current RTA program, is, and innovative within PAG is our widespread adoption of roadway safety assessments. And that program is a program that PAG had that helps, that basically brings in multiple points of view. We have a jurisdiction has to say, hey, I have a safety issue and I want you guys to check it out and give me your opinion on how to fix it, right? Like, we have to have a partner that asks for help. We're not just going to go in and tell them what to do, right? And so when we make that request, we have an engineering, you know, we have a set of safety engineers that bring in, that look at the data, that bring in transit riders, that bring in enforcement officers that whose beat it is, that say, yeah, every day at 4:30 when, you know, after school's let out, then things start to heat up, right? You know, like they know that situation. And this curve, when the sun hits it, they all chime in from the transit rider perspective, from the visual impaired perspective, to the ADA perspective. They have that that exercise, and we do that for existing facilities. But one of the innovative things that the RTA has done is establish a requirement, but it happens every time after the success of the initial ones, was a design RSA. So when we get to the 80% plans or whatever the percentage is, but fairly long down along in the design process where we know where poles are going to go more or less, but there's still time to make an impact, and it's going to be much less expensive than after concrete's poured, there is a design level RSA looking at how do we make sure this new deployment, this new construction project isn't going to make the situation worse, right? Because sometimes that's happened, and you have to go back and fix it. So to keep that from happening, there is this really kind of collaborative exercise to look at it while it's still in the design phase. And that is part of how, you know, things can get tightened up in the design. And that is a very intentional exercise. And I'll try to stop talking. I believe Brian and then Patricia.
Yeah, go ahead, Brian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Actually, I had a question for Ava. I'm sorry. I'd like to have just a little dialogue here. Just forgive me. I'm born and raised in this town and I deal with visuals. So when you say there's intersections that have been completed that are larger in scope nor massive, and you have concerns about the safety in that, would you mind just giving
Broadway
me like
Broadway and Grant Road?
Okay.
Ones that jump quickly to mind.
Just those two stretches, or is there a particular intersections? Cause I do
the intersection of Campbell, the intersection of Campbell and Broadway, for example, okay. Grant and Oracle, you know, I could look at a map and give you some others too.
Yeah. And honestly, I mean, I can envision them too, right? Like Broadway and Wilmont is a very large intersection and a lot of lanes flowing through there. So it's not lost on me what you're pointing out. I just wonder, Mr. Chair, or anybody from the group, if we have safety statistics from prior to the design or the basically redevelopment of those intersections, both before mm-hmm. and after, whether it's improved. And then I wonder if there was lessons learned, you know, after we moved on, that if those were to be redone today, they would be done differently.
Because to illustrate my point a little bit more, you know, Grant and Oracle, you know, we've had a couple of pedestrian deaths there pretty recently. And that's also basically the site where the city wants to build a huge new affordable housing development. So that's going to be more non-motorized, you know, traffic. It's going to be more pedestrians in an area where pedestrians are already dying. So, you know, of course, this is why I'm asking so many questions.
Sure.
About safety, right? So that's one, you know, illustration that jumps right to mind, right? The Grant and Oracle intersection.
Well, thank you. And honestly, Mr. Chair, thank you for giving me an opportunity just kind of for the open dialogue like this, because I think a lot of committee members are a lot more aligned in a lot of these areas than maybe we realize. Safety is of huge, huge concern for me across, you know, sure. all modalities. And it's important that we see that. And I always believe that there are things we can do better in the future than maybe we've done in the past. So, but again, being born and raised here, living here my entire life and seeing these roadways change over that, I just like visuals because I can envision specifically what you're saying. So thank you. Thank you for those examples.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And you know, it's, I'm glad Ava brought this up because it really is kind of the bane of traffic engineers' existence. You know, that in order to fix congestion, you have traditionally widened roadways to a level that would allow that throughput to be for of the motorized vehicles to be adequate, right? And in doing so, you add more lanes. And then the traffic requires you to get dual left turn lanes and right turn lanes and bus pullouts and bicycle facilities. And before you know it, you've got acres of land out there, and you have to try to get wheelchairs or, you know, physically impaired pedestrians across, and the best you can do is get them halfway, and then you need to have a refuge there, and therein, you know, becomes a lot of more conflict points. So those are all issues that traffic engineers are trying to weigh, and certainly the engineers for the jurisdictions, you know, understand that, you know, much of the intersection problems come with the fact that we're addressing them, you know, that we're trying to get them wide enough to function properly, that is properly for cars. And, you know, that's why I'm very interested to see the priorities that the various agencies are placing on each type of project that they have. And that's why I kept asking, you know, are we going to be able to look at the different kinds of projects as well, so that we can dive into some of those that are the higher priority and see in what way they try to impact these other safety problems that we have, not just vehicular safety, but other safety.
And I would think that that's an expression of a number of the city projects where they're not necessarily addressing congestion. You'll see there'll be like three green bars there for congestion, but two big red safety issues that they recognize, and likely probably poor sidewalks as an indication of, you know, access issues and some of those other contributing factors. So, and that's not to mean that the other jurisdictions don't have that. It's just an example that jumps out because we are talking about some of the bigger city intersections.
Yeah. Patricia.
Go ahead.
Brian, were you still?
It might've been Rick.
I was going to add to yours, Brian, and Ava's comment, just as an additional thing. Sometimes safety is going to be a explicit purpose in there. It'll be called out directly. And if that's the primary focus, you'll see it a little more obvious in the form of what's going to be taken. To get to some of the points Ava and Brian were talking about, the projects that we're building now even work to incorporate the latest and greatest safety protocols. You mentioned Grant and Oracle. The configuration of that was changed from a traditional intersection to what we call an indirect left. That helps shrink down intersection. That helps separate some of those movements that may or may not have been causing issues in the past, either in terms of congestion or safety. Helps give it a little smaller footprint so that the pedestrian activity is more conducive to that. And Tom hit right on it. It's a balancing act. We're trying to accommodate a lot of things in forms of bus, transit, vehicular, bike, ped, all those. And sometimes they don't coexist harmoniously, and we've got to strike a balance on how those can all coexist the best way possible. In addition, a lot of the detailed design work that Josh alluded to through our safety practices identify even better practices where we can tighten things up. We don't use as big a radii or as big a dimensioning as we did 15 or 20 years ago. We've tightened it down and narrowed it even more. Sometimes we're shopping for single digit number of feet, but you add 1 foot for five lanes and you have a 5 foot dimension. All of a sudden, that's a little bit more conducive to XYZ type of facility. So some of that is built in explicitly. Some of it is inherently implied and is incorporated throughout the just general application of best practices and latest and greatest thinking and in a learning type of organizational mentality. So Tom wanted to expand on that. Apologize for the interruption.
So I believe Patricia was next, then Kevin.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you all for the insight shed on this. I think this grounded sort of example with safety is helpful for me, and I don't want to derail this conversation because obviously we've heard a lot in both committees about how important safety is to a lot of the committee members. So I don't mean to derail the specifics of safety, but I do have some broader questions just in terms of like our goals of this subcommittee and like the scope of work that we have ahead of us that I wanted to get into. So if there's more things to be said about safety in this flow, then let's do that. But when we do get a minute or when it seems appropriate, I'd like to like zoom out a little bit if that's possible.
And I have a zoom out point before we go back into the weeds. I was gonna try to kind of step through a refresher of what we touched on and then pause for that zoom out moment to kind of discuss two potential paths that were raised. So I can get us there, and I appreciate your comments to help move it along.
Yeah, it's really, really timely comment. And you know, the more time we spend solving these problems, more time we've really wasted, because we'll have to go back through them again with the entire committee. We really want to focus on a framework for presenting these projects that allow everyone on the committee to do some of the in the weeds evaluations that we're talking about in generalities right now. Kevin?
Yeah, I was going to just mention one more thing on the intersections. That I don't think anybody mentioned yet, but we have to also worry about freight. And like there's some intersections where we want to accommodate a WB62, which is an interstate tractor trailer, like turning, for example, making a dual left or something like that with zero overlap with any of the other lanes or anything like that. And that just makes for some very, very large intersections at times. So I think we need to be a little bit smarter as jurisdictions in the area and kind of decide which roadways, for lack of a better word, this is really important on, which ones maybe we can relax those standards. So anyhow, because that does make for really big intersections, really tough design task. And then I did want to mention that I think we would do things slightly differently now than maybe in the past. Like, for example, on Grant, one of the intersections is going to be a protected intersection, which really narrows up the crossing distance for both bikes and peds. So I think, you know, things as we move forward more using the state-of-the-art design techniques and things like that should help. I mean, we're learning all the time. And then finally, and then I think we can move on. I was talking to Jonathan Crow from the county at Roads and Streets, and he said that the county used, I believe he said he started with the PAG, kind of the evaluation, and then they added their own like livability things like that into the weighting and scoring to come up with their scores for what they submitted last month. They did this over the last couple months. I thought he said he worked with PAG on that.
The city and the county brought both of them were new. One didn't exist before. One was an update. Project rankings, and you know, 1 to 23. I think the county had 21 projects, and the city's was based on their Move Tucson exercise, which really leaned heavily on the safety and equity. In addition to the, you know, the outreach that they did with the public in their ward offices. And then the counties had basically they started with the, you know, how you can download the Excel from this platform. They downloaded that data and then they appended it with some additional attributes, and they provided a new ranking. And okay. So it is largely based on our data that you see, that you all have access to, plus some additional fields, but ultimately it's translated into their 1 to 21 ranking order that is updated in the site right now.
Okay. Yeah, I guess my point was going to be maybe looking at what they did may help us move forward with what we're looking at as well.
Okay. Good point.
Ava, I just had one follow-up question. Yeah, quick follow-up question. Josh, you had mentioned that there's like a design level RSA, is I believe what you called it, where where different types of users kind of give their experience of the intersection or the project or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. That only happens upon invitation, or what was the...
Yeah, so the RSA program is this, you know, this national program that we applied and we made available to our jurisdiction partners. And so as a regional entity, we don't own any assets, right? And so we're not going to go in and start telling our jurisdictional partners what they need to do with their stuff. If they ask us, hey, we're seeing an issue here, we would like to get your input on this. That's when we, and so this program has been in place. That's when, I believe it's a two-week exercise where the first week, the in-house staff, Rick, a colleague of mine, Gabe Thumb is our safety expert, and he works with a list of on-call traffic and safety transportation engineers to digest, to check out the extent of the project, dig through the data, look at the characteristics of the facilities. And then in week two, there's a kickoff meeting with all the stakeholders, the facility owner, and those other stakeholders that I'd mentioned. And then there's like, it's a 2-day turnaround where there's a really intensive exercise, and then a series of recommendations are provided. And then the point of it is that then the jurisdiction would respond to those recommendations, like, hey, these are the striping issues that you can address. You know, these are the cheap ones that you can do now. These are the bigger ones that you need to deal with later. They're going to cost more money, but these are ways to improve it. So that's the program that exists, that our partners appreciate and that we fund support. That has been interpreted into a design level one, where we have our jurisdictional partners who are going to be building the facility are looking at the plans and visualizing, you know, where are those conflicts going to be? Because we know enough, you know, we have to wait till the plans are developed enough so that they can make those, they can see it and they can make those inferences of, you know, their professional understanding of what are going to be conflict points that can be eliminated. And so that is an RTA exercise that takes place with new RTA construction projects that are happening to try to, you know, just put that safety lens on it.
That's so awesome. Thank you, Josh. Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay. Last one before we let Josh actually move on. Kevin, you want to have the last word for now?
No, I was just going to mention it because I don't think Josh had mentioned it until he did right at the very end. I think it is required for all RTA projects, correct?
That's relatively new, like last 5-6 years or so. So, you know, it was a pilot that they tried out, and then it was really well received. There are savings in lives, you know, so it then became a requirement.
Yeah, I wanted to make sure everybody understood that that is something the RTA can require when there's RTA funds involved.
Thank you.
That was it.
So fresher on last time we met, I presented a couple different frameworks that were that data-driven exercise where you start out with the performance goal, performance target. You get some data that helps you assess how you're doing towards that target. And then this third column here is, and that second column, that performance measure, that's the data and that assessment. So like, is a high number good or is a low number good? You know, like, what does that number mean? And then that weight, I may be conflating some concepts with weight. That weight is also referenced as kind of how it's how many points it can equal as you kind of get to a score. And so is it going to be worth 10 points if it's poorly performing or 20 points if it's poorly performing? And so that weight gives you the score, and then as you bring in your other goals and your other performance measures and you have those weights, you know, 10, 10, 10, 10, or 10, 20, 20, 10, whatever it is, you can then get to that composite score. And this weight is where, you know, some of the values can be implied. It can be further emphasized rather, because, you know, your values are going to be expressed in your goals. So that is this framework. It's state of the practice, largely on account of federal FAST Act requirements. About 5 years ago, Fed say, hey, start having data-driven planning and programming. So everybody in the transportation planning and programming realm started working towards this. And so ADOT has an exercise that we touched on, and our PAG's long-range plan has an exercise that we touched on, and so does the city. ADOT's exercise has multiple criteria for different buckets of projects. So you don't have the same criteria for your pavement preservation project list as you do as your modernization project list. So those are actually four different scoring regimes, four different data, collection of data and scoring regimes. So that is a construct that's out there. The one that we have with the RMAP, we really had one construct where we were just looking at one bucket of large name projects essentially. And so as I kind of presented that, there we go, a little laggy. I touched on like three different scores. That was kind of showing you the messiness of our exercise, where one of the scores was looking at all of the transportation, the total transportation impact. The second score was looking at only the ones that were relevant to that corridor. And then the third one was an interpretation of the first one with a cost per mile tagged on to it, so that you can see what's that relative monetary, what is the number of performance areas that you're hitting that are poorly performing, and let's normalize that with cost per mile, so that you're not spending a crazy amount of money on something that is hitting all the targets, but you have another one that may hit six of the targets instead of six of the poorly performing areas, but maybe at a tenth of the cost. Let's do more of those. So that is the idea between those different scoring regimes.
Hey, Josh, these are really small letters.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I couldn't see them, but just give us an idea of, with each of those options, what's the difference in the comparison of those two projects that you were looking at? In other words, does one rise above the other on all three, or on two of the three, or
it kind of gets tricky. We showed an example where the one doesn't it starts to perform better when you look at that project cost and length. The numbers are going to change, and they should change across those three different ones, or what's the point of having three different ones if they're all the same number? So it does kind of share different information. I would think that we may want to lean towards one if we want to go this route, and honestly, I didn't add all those slides in because I just kind of wanted to be a bit of a refresher. So I'm sorry, Tom, I don't really have.
No, that's fine. Okay. Keep going.
Yeah. And then ultimately it's a number, right? It's a data point in which is an expression of those goals. But it's a number that you're going to want to have, You want to have an understanding of, you want to have a comfort level with, but it's not going to dictate, it shouldn't dictate the dialogue and the decision-making process that it's incorporated in. So it has to be placed in the context of the jurisdiction priorities, or the sub-area distribution, or in the context of our broader discussion, what's that. What is the regional distribution of projects? And so at the end of the day, it's just a number. And there should, I don't want to just count it or discredit it, because decent amount of energy would likely go into it. But it's not the end all be all. It's to help support the process, help try to translate a lot of performance measures that are a reflection of your goals, and trying to take that down into to one number as a point of reference. And, you know, and I think in the discussion we had, and so, you know, if we move forward with this, you know, we have the current RMAP PMs there as a point of reference. You know, there was a discussion about, well, you know, maybe we look, we may want to look within a region, or rather within a jurisdiction, and start, well, how do projects score within a sponsor submitted set of projects? Well, how does that then relate to their priorities? How does that relate to the TNC priority, you know, out of that exercise? So there are going to be some other pieces of information along the way, right? And so how you use that number, and how you, what your group by statement is, you know, are you looking at it by project type with respect to capacity improvements, or project type as it relates to transit improvements? You know, like there are different ways to kind of group it. Or are you just looking at that number with respect to jurisdiction or sub area? You can use it a number of different ways. And that's where I think there was a lot of feedback. We got a lot of good feedback from the TMC workshop, because there was that dialogue, and that was a different cohort, right? Those were transportation professionals whose job it is to think about this stuff and take care of their constituents, and be responsive to their leadership. And they kind of had a certain level of understanding about these projects and the needs from their perspective, and they were able to have those discussions and have those dialogues. The county went through a prioritization exercise using this kind of same theme. I mentioned Patrick, who helped put together the city's one, helped build this. Well, our boss was Paul when we put this together, and he's over to the county and helped them put that list together, that schema, that assessment criteria schema that they built out, helped them put that together. So it's state of the practice. It's not perfect. It's a point of reference. And, you know, and that's kind of where I wanted to Patricia's point, zoom out. And like, that is what I presented. There was good discussion about how do we get to the qualitative component, you know, how should we consider that? Basically what I have prepared, the next slides I have prepared are a listing of the goals and some initial kind of data points to discuss and to kind of start that discussion. If that's a path we want to go through. I mean, I did hear towards the end, I mean, there was a number of members expressing interest in, you know, wanting to have outcomes based and I feel this gets us closer to that. But we can also look at a more qualitative base way to look at it, and maybe an individual assessment of individual CAC member assessment of how they feel the project addresses the CAC goals. That's a different path. That's a path we can take. And so I guess hey, I kind of want to bring it up. And so Tom, go, please take the floor.
Yeah. I think for our purposes, nothing takes the place of face-to-face debate and argument and negotiation and discussion. And this is intended to be a tool that allows us to do that. As an example, someone who comes from a emphasis on pedestrian safety may place a much higher weight on the pedestrian, you know, problems at a, for a given project, as opposed to someone else who may be more of a, you know, a throughput. How many vehicles can we get here? Because we need to reduce the travel time for freight and for people going to work. But that conversation, so this tool should be able to be manipulated, if you will, or used to emphasize those things that those individual committee members believe to be the most important part about a project, so that you can have that conversation, you can have that discussion in a group where you can say, well, look, if you put a reasonable weight on these two items, suddenly you flip-flop, you know, the ranking, and let people discuss that and talk about it. I don't think we ever get to the point where we just say the number's the number, and
right.
That, and therefore we'll take the top 10 numbers and boom, we're done. Right. It doesn't make sense. It's not what the public will be looking for from us. And I don't think it stands any kind of scrutiny anyway. Right. So that's where I see the value of the tool. It's kind of introducing some objectivity to a subjective process. Ava. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think what comes to mind, it would be really interesting to have a list of what are the data sets that are currently being input into this tool or that we currently have available. And what would a list of theoretical data sets that would help us to, you know, be able to talk about our goals, what would that look like? I think there are like two lists that I'm thinking about that would come out of that. And I also heard really good things about the TMC retreat process. And that sounds like something that maybe the CAC could take as a model for, you know, reviewing, you know, some where some of this data starts to come, how it starts to fall and rank things.
Great. I can tackle that. And I think that was heard pretty loud and clear from Monday's meeting by most, you know, PAG RTA staff, that there was expressed interest in being able to have that kind of workshop experience, or, you know, that that dialogue, because I you know, we put energy into making that a structured discussion where I wish I would have really brought this out, like, you know, we did the breakouts, we at CAC meeting on Monday, we said, yeah, we did the breakouts and there was discussion. Well, you know, we had a couple of steps towards that. And the first step was the jurisdictional partners who had their sponsored projects in that sub area got to talk about the projects, you know, and some people talked a lot more about their projects, other people didn't, you know, like, but it was kind of up to them. And we had, you know, we had resources available, printouts kind of, you know, of this grid. And then, you know, with some of those numbers and some of those metrics, just as points of reference and those project slides. And then the next step was we kind of had the group identify regional significant corridors, just to kind of get them talking and putting dots on the map and thinking through it. And then we had them think about what are those hot button projects, which ones are going to be controversial, you know, and none of those steps started excluding anything. It was just like, hey, let's start talking about these projects and coming in from different angles on the projects. And then the kind of the fourth step, which was pretty wide open, was let's start moving towards a priority list. You can look at your jurisdictional ranks. You can look at, you know, the data. You can look at, you know, you can look at different measures. But let's kind of have that dialogue at once they are warmed up and with the intent of pulling down that cost, right? So that's something we could do with folks who live and breathe this stuff all the time. You guys are at this stage more up to speed than the average citizen on transportation issues. But, you know, to get a similar exercise, we would have to be kind of thoughtful about what we bring to the table. And so we're looking at that. We need to figure out the timing, right? And also, so I think that that is an objective. Personally, I would like to see this work group come to a decision that feel good about on what this tool can be, how it's deployed, and you know how it's available, so that that can be brought into that, that can be a point of reference in that discussion. I mean, to me, that would be the ideal timing, is that we could get all of our ducks in a row and all of our stuff set up and processed and available, and we feel good about it, and then we're able to share that with the CAC, so that you know when game time comes, whenever that is, if we're able to do that, then there will be some familiarity with what that data point means and what context it should be addressed in, and then there can be that dialogue around it. The other thing that was definitely heard was, and was conveyed in this working group last time, is the interest of CAC members to hear from the jurisdictional partners about the projects. And so we're looking to try to, you know, what's the timing of that? Is that the next CAC meeting? Is that the potential workshop? What, you know, what would be that appropriate pattern pacing for you all? Because that's a big part of it. But to get to through this exercise with you all and this working group, you know, if we want to do that, you know, data-driven exercise, we kind of get need to get moving on next steps. You wanted to list. I don't have lists. I have slides. I have slides that kind of start establish placeholders for of the performance measures that we have at our fingertips right here, which ones might be meaningful with the goals. So I literally have however many more, 5, 6 more slides with 2 or 3 of the goals with some of the data performance measures referenced to support that discussion. The other list of data is going to be in that legend. You know, that's our best available information. Excuse me.
Well, Josh, I think those are going to come up, and you can start a list of those data points that either don't exist or are not currently part of our database when we go through those slides. So I think it's a perfect time to segue into that.
I'm ready to go there. I guess I also wanted to make sure, like, the qualitative component, I don't want to, whatever, we can leave it open. I don't want this path to like shut that door, but I also want us to recognize we need to think about if we want to bring that in, how do we bring it in? And so maybe it'll become apparent as some of those data gaps show up in the goals, and like maybe that's where we bring in some of the qualitative, and you know, how are we going to do that? Because I'm not sure. Is everybody so Tom, you're good with me moving forward? Is that cool with the group?
Cool. Yeah, well, yeah. Just to say, per your question, how do we do that? That's why I was really interested in getting a presentation from Move Tucson to see how they did it.
So, good question. I am, if I click this button, looking at their method. You can go and Google Move Tucson Project Prioritization Framework. It's a 5-page PDF. It breaks down their steps. Patrick touched on them last time. They're a little bit different. I mean, they did a network screen and applied it to the network, and then they selected projects. We're not at that stage. We're at the point where we have the projects. He also stole that idea from me. It's okay. It's fine. But we where we applied the network score so that people could say, hey, if I delineate a project here, it's going to be poorly performing on more project areas. And that's essentially what they did. And but as you step through that document, you can see where they have, I believe, 12 different guiding principles, They have their measure, they have their data source, they have their scoring notes, and then they have their score. So I maybe have condensed it to four steps, and Patrick's really verbose and he's not on the call, so I'm just going to keep calling him out.
it's cool. I'll Google it.
Yeah. But essentially that flow, those five steps are very similar in nature to those blue boxes that I was showing before. So there are some references, I would say, on the qualitative component. They had an outreach effort, and honestly, I don't know that we're going to have time for that given this stage of the cycle. There's going to be an outreach component, but I don't think we're going to be able to incorporate it into our scoring regime. That input's going to be received and incorporated in a different stage of our process, right? But they did look at public support based on some of their outreach and whether or not has the project been identified as a priority through public input, or have representatives of Tucson ward offices identified projects important for further ward goals? So those are two qualitative things that are like, hey, we're getting telephone calls all the time from at the ward office about this issue. We want to make sure that that's going to be considered, right? Or through their outreach, did they hear about it? And the proposed scoring in their regime is 2 points if the project is identified in the public engagement, there must be identified or liked by more than two participants. So, you know, that was kind of that threshold that they did. You know, we have this data set, but, you know, what is a meaningful public input? And there were three available points assigned to that authentic guiding principle. So that's a way in which they were able to incorporate that more qualitative public component. But most of the other guiding principles are, you know, are explicit data sets, and most of them are what you're seeing. They're different interpretations, but most of them are what are currently in the data portal. It's another document that they reference the source, and I would say at least half, if not more, are from us, from PAG. So with that, you know, this exercise here, I wish I would have reordered it, because the very first goal is really kind of challenging to look at with this construct.
You have a back button, don't you?
A back button?
Yeah, go forward and come back.
There we go. crashes, there we are. Only thing we talk about, which is important in our region because it's an issue. Ava, are we good to kind of move through here? Others?
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. Thank you.
So with this goal of reduced crashes among vehicles, bicycles, pedestrians, and others, I really do feel that the level of safety service is a very good performance metric. We made the decision to separate it to intersections and roadways because they're really different crash characteristics that occur at intersections and versus roadways, and there's different solutions that are required to address those to the degree that engineering investment can affect the crashes. But that's why we have two and we didn't drop it into one. So I feel like this is a really solid one. I recognize bicycles and pedestrians are called out here or are identified here, but it was also buffeted by the vehicles and others. So I feel that the intersection and roadway level of safety service is very comprehensive. As you know, with respect to the city's exercise, they had, I believe, a pedestrian high impact network or something. I don't think they use the word impact, but it's something along those lines. It's an I forget what it is. when you look at, they use that plus some other metrics to prioritize their list. When they brought that list over, they were also poorly performing in our level of safety service. So there was a significant amount of overlap. So I feel as if this is an area where we have a pretty solid performance measure to consider. I'll just kind of go through and we can kind of then come back. Reduce wildlife related crashes and provide wildlife connectivity. Eva, you'd also asked, what's the list of data available? Those color coded grid on that project portal is that high level performance assessment grid, that little visual there. When you click on the project name, you get a 10-page project report. That first page of the project report is an executive summary of what the heck those 10 colored boxes mean. And it goes into a breakdown of what does it mean when pavement is red? Well, we're looking at the IRI. What the heck is IRI? Each of those supplemental pages goes into a little bit more detail of what pavement is, what bridge condition is, what's the data source on bridge, what is a poorly performing bridge. So I mentioned that because we have an environmental impact performance measure in our long range plan. And I do feel as if this is a good, the one we have in RMAP is a good indicator, performance measure for most of this goal. In speaking with our resident environmental advocate, I was going to try to think of a better way of describing Carolyn, a more radical way of describing Carolyn. We talked about the absence of wildlife related crash data, and how we have a safety platform to go really deep into the safety issues that touches on all the things we've previously seen. Wildlife related auto crashes from the auto perspective, which is how we're getting crash reports, are very small. I'm not saying they don't exist, but they are relatively small. And then looking at wildlife related crashes from a side of the road.
Biological perspective.
Yeah, the dead animals on the road. I'm sorry, I'm blanking on the terminology there. Those sorts of inventories, that is also few and far between. And Carolyn was suggesting that's not really a great measure. What we do have are the wildlife corridors. That is a data set. And I wish I could bring up the site. The wildlife corridors was a project. Crystal, would I be able to do that or no?
Yeah, if you have it up, I can take down the slides and you can share.
Okay.
Let me see what you want to try that?
Yeah. And then I may need
and
to switch.
And then just let me know and I'll put them back up when you're ready.
Great. Thank you.
So Josh, basically what you're looking for is a visual that shows wildlife corridors, and then you can overlay them with projects and you can see where there's an intersection of a right. wildlife corridor and a a multimodal corridor, and right. In those you can look to see whether there are bridges that essentially function as wildlife passages. If there are not, and then you're probably going to have to look to see whether there's any anecdotal information from Fish and Wildlife or from, you know, the animal services of the city or the county or the town in question, in order to say, yeah, this needs something, and then see whether that project description includes that. And that's kind of what I would have anticipated that would have gone into the development of these plans, or at least the scopes of work for these plans, for these projects that we've already seen brought forward. Does that make sense?
Correct. And that's that. It may not be as detailed as we would like. You know, I think they're kind of fairly, like, there may be a paragraph describing how performance is addressed or the goals are addressed. So, as opposed to this project, you know, explicitly addressing the wildlife linkages problem, you know, or concern. Right. So Crystal, I'm unable to share my screen. It's saying host is disabled, participant screen sharing. So, I guess without the visual, Arizona Game and Fish, there was an RTA funded project.
Try it now, Josh.
Thank you. To map out those corridors, and perfect. Thank you. And so, you know, if you go to, I have to click share. If you go to the project review page and you go to the map, you know, all of this data is expressed spatially here, right? Plus some. And so I would say this would be, I probably should pull, like, stop looking after businesses, because this is more related to the detailed cost estimate exercise that we're anticipating getting into. Anyhow, basically, you know, the bike ped count, the bicycle network, all of this, you know, our hawks, our push button crossings, you know, all of this information is at your fingertips here. And it's digested here to the degree. The environmental sensitive areas, these wildlife linkages, are those Arizona Game and Fish developed. Carolyn was, that's not what I want to do. Sorry. I'm looking over here, my camera's here and shouldn't have done that. She expressed confidence in that exercise when it was done a little while ago at the beginning of the RTA to look at those wildlife linkages and the community involvement. So it's that yellow hatching, which is really hard to see, but if you add in the Sonoran Desert Conservation Plan as it was integrated into the Habitat Conservation Plan of the county, these are the important riparian areas, and then other priority biological resource areas. So as you look at a, let's see, an area that has environmental impact, let's click on this guy. So that's crossing through an important riparian area. So it's just like a heads up, like, hey, you're gonna be crossing through that. So I feel let's look at some of the other environmental impact projects. Ugh. There's a few, right? And let's zoom out. Let's get our projects back in. So one of the projects that would likely come in, you know, this project is kind of running through the, you see it's kind of hitting all of them, the wildlife linkages, priority riparian areas, and other priority biological resource areas. Because it is a new project, we grade everything out, but that is an example where, you know, that project is crossing through that critical habitat area, and we, you know, we just wanted to kind of be able to note it. I'm trying to look for where it is. This area, I think both two partners submitted projects in this extent, and both of them were very cognizant of the wildlife linkage that this area presents with this Twin Peaks, this connectivity here. So I would suggest that we have a pretty good expression of that. We're not going to be able to quantify how many wildlife we're going to save, but it's also like, hey, if we build a project here, we're going to need to be very well aware of fencing or passage investments in accommodating those wildlife issues in those areas. So I do feel as if this environmental impact flag is a good one that tells us that we are in an area that needs attention. Because for the projects that we don't have, I mean, you know, there are some areas of town that don't have a significant amount. I was focusing on the areas of town that did. So I do feel we have a good expression of that from county and RTA data sets for that performance measure.
Yeah, Josh, I agree with that. And this is kind of what I was trying to get at when I said that we wanted to have some objective data or things that we could use in a subjective dialogue. And you know, this would be kind of one of those. While you might not have something as technical as a level of safety service for wildlife, you certainly have enough information there to flag important projects and potential areas that need to be beefed up in order to, you know, take care of those issues.
And now, if you all have been on the site since Monday at 4, we've incorporated the TMC priority filters, and so you can then, you know, I'm not suggesting you only look at them, but that's a starting point. And you'll notice that those two examples that I reference aren't that on their priority list right now. So doesn't mean you can't bring them in, but the members didn't want to move those forward.
Josh, on that, I noticed that you can sort by jurisdiction, and then those are listed in a 1 through 21 or 1 through 4, mm-hmm. or however many they have. And I'm presuming that those are listed in that rank order that they've developed themselves, correct?
Correct. This is the sponsor rank.
Yep. Okay, good. Everybody else's.
Yeah, very okay. much so. And the city brought theirs to the table on that Thursday, and we loaded it into the system that morning. And so you have access to that. And then the county provided a list as well, mm-hmm. That day. So these numbers are current based on jurisdiction submittal. Okay, Crystal, do you mind pulling up the slides again? Do I have to stop share? I'm going to stop sharing. Thank you. So I feel that this is a decent expression. I think it's a good, I think it's the best available expression that a lot of money and community buy-in went into. And we didn't just make it up. Improve the conditions of existing infrastructure for all modes. So, you know, we do have that pavement and bridge condition index. I mean, that's kind of when the term condition is referenced, many people think of potholes, right? Or failing bridges. So, and or sidewalks that are inconsistent. So, and bike paths. So I feel the all modes would be addressed if we looked at pavement, bridges, that sidewalk presence. I must admit, it's an older data set. It's not expressing ADA related issues, pulling in ADA issues is going to be is outside of the scope of our time frame, unfortunately. That is going to be that's a $1 million exercise in itself for the city of Tucson. They step through it, but we don't have that consistently for all of our regional partners. So I think we're going to have to use our best proxy of presence of sidewalk to kind of, that's our best available data set. And then, oh, so that was changed to pathways. So we have bikeways. We have a bikeways data layer that's in that map. It's in the map that we distribute for new whatever in the region. So we know where the bike lanes are. We know where the shared use paths are. We know where the bike boulevards are and enhanced bikeways and separated bikeways. So we can use that information. That's a data point that we can consider. What we do with it, that's the next step of the discussion, which we kind of need. This for pavement and bridges, we have that condition assessment fairly well defined by the feds, honestly, but how to incorporate sidewalk and bikeways, we need to think about how we want to do that. The way we're bringing in presence of sidewalk here is kind of a different, serving a different goal, but we do have that data and we may want to think about what that threshold and what that interpretation needs to be for those last two pieces. But this information is at our fingertips. Kevin?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, do we need to include transit in here, either transit routes or maybe the condition of the bus shelters, if they even have bus shelters, anything like that? Should that be included?
That's a really good point. That's why I wanted to have this discussion, right? Like, because I didn't just throw this together this morning. I put a lot of transit component, yeah. Now I do, and we'll get into this pretty quickly. There's a lot of overlap in the goals. And so where we have kind of clean separation, duly noted, all of modes of transportation should include transit. Thank you. But there are other places in which transit condition. Bus shelters. Okay. So maybe we go back then before we go forward. So manage and reduce congestion by using strategies and tools such as travel demand management and ITS, intelligent transportation systems. So in terms of like an existing condition, like what's the ability to make a positive impact on a poor condition? Like in reading this, manage and reduce congestion by X is we're going to be looking at congestion is the nut we're trying to crack here, right? So congestion data, is this a poorly performing congestion corridor? Yes, no, or whatever the gradient is on that. We got that. We can do that. But then what do we do with the intent of this goal, which is to have congestion? A goal is to manage and reduce congestion by a particular means, set of means. That's going to be that interpretation of the project scope. So, so we're gonna have to think about that. You know, one way we can do it is, you know, I might need to save. Anyhow, I guess I just want to open that up. Like,
yeah, Tom, what are your thoughts? Let's just ask everybody on this call what they make of that. Was this intended to simply be a set aside bucket for using like travel demand management, ITS, smart vehicle technology, whatever the tech issues might be that would allow for congestion reduction without widening, I guess is kind of what I saw there.
Yeah.
However, we still have congestion elsewhere in our guidelines through more traditional means, obviously. And so I saw this as an additional emphasis on being open to those kinds of projects that can be influenced without widening. And I think we see that in some of the projects that have come forward from the various agencies. Anybody else have a take on that?
Tom, Brian here.
Go ahead, Brian.
I want to echo what you said and just say ditto. I think, as I recall from this, the conversation was, we have some more modern intersections that have technology built in to read the flow of traffic, where we have some older intersections that don't have that. And the signals are based strictly off of timers, and it doesn't look at what's actually happening in the intersection, moment by moment. So I think this was looking at how rapidly technology is advancing. And I don't think any of us can predict out where 20 years from now, it's really where it would be, but just being open to methods to move traffic without necessarily having to widen. If the problem could be addressed with technology without having to widen, then that was optimal.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And this may be a good time. All right. Does anybody else want to chime in? Because I kind of want to pivot. So, or not pivot, but I want to introduce something to this discussion. But any other thoughts? With that, Tom had mentioned on Monday and again today, and we talked about the project types. That is a that Rick had stepped through in a previous presentation of capacity expansion, new roadway, transit, and then functionalization and Rick, please start talking now about your project types. We may be able to, I think it would be healthy, like that may be something that we can lean on that then kind of helps, if it's a project that states squarely or presents itself in an operationalization or a functionalization improvement that isn't necessarily going to be adding capacity, additional lanes, then that's gonna be something that gets at this goal, Rick, does that?
And then that was part of that whole kind of classification or identifying project types, was to set the stage for that. How do we distinguish between, okay, we're ripping up the road, but what is our purpose? What is our goal? And Tom, I guess I'm gonna ask you kind of on that. Crystal's got the slides, not the full presentation I gave back this summer, but I can bring up the definition slides or I can read them to you as kind of a refresher of that and how we compartmentalized, if that would help. If you think that would benefit this group at all.
Yeah, I do want to make sure we have time to get through the other performance measures to make sure we talk about them. But yeah, the thought it did occur to me that a project type may include, a tech congestion type of a project. And I don't know that you had it down refined to that level. In fact, I think you would probably, if you wanted to do that, you would say, certain of the projects in several of the other types may have aspects of this one.
And they are going to cross over across all that. That's a general inherent built-in thing. So it's going to be, hey, we're using state-of-the-art. I think Josh used that term, and that's an accurate description of it, is that all projects, regardless of the type. So as Josh said, you know, the capacity jobs are getting towards congestion through the traditional methods of widening. But that's also going to incorporate all the latest and greatest means and methods and technology advancements so that that system that works in its maximum capability to it.
Okay. So, yeah. so maybe this goal isn't a good one to necessarily use that, but just, you know, we can potentially use a couple of data sets to, like, you know, hey, if it's in this group, if it's in this project type, then we maybe that could be something that can be applied. So
it does lend itself. The project types did, they can work in that description and that discussion, because we did recognize there's a difference. Like I said, even though it may be ripping up the roadway and rebuilding it, it's not going to do it in a widened type of manner. It's going to rely either on, hey, we're adequate with the number of lanes we've got, and we just simply need to enhance the other functional components, or we recognize it's right on thresholds and other simple little adjustments, or the advent of technology will bring us back to a fully functioning facility without that degraded performance. Okay. So we do have them separated, not in that kind of specific of these are relying only on those TDM type of strategies or ITS. Those would be built in, but we also did differentiate between, hey, this is going to be a primary purpose widening, operations, functional, or transit. We did separate them that way.
Kevin?
Yes, I guess I was wondering, this seems like it might be a good category for a sub-element or categorical, perhaps, yeah. Like a pot of money for TDM or a pot of money for ITS, something maybe for the larger group that may be a good spot for it too.
I agree, and it seems like that's... There, some of the bigger projects, if there's going to be a multi-modal corridor, that's likely going to have a portion of which that addresses ITS and is going to have maybe fiber going in, or, you know, the intersections are going to be getting upgraded. So that's going to be kind of a challenging one to carve out explicitly.
And that measurement is against the whole plan. So Josh, and Kevin are going down there. That there may be elements where that's suited for a categorical, because it's going to go to an area where that's the only deficiency is a signalized intersection or intersections on a whole corridor that need an upgrade to maximize their operations. And that may be a simple adjustment that is better handled through a potential categorical than it would be through designating a big line item roadway corridor.
Yeah, but I think there's also the question of the when. You know, as one of the reasons this one came up was because we know that since 2006, there have been, you know, orders of magnitude improvement in wayfinding, just as one example of technology that is in common use now. And we don't know what those next two or three, you know, tech, you know, improvements are going to be, although.
So we have to fund it every 5 years.
Yeah. So, yeah.
We have to continue the maintenance of it, just like pavement. As it deteriorates, we have 30 years.
And we don't know when they'll occur, but right. I think we know what many of them are likely to be. And I think a big part of all the projects ought to be preparing for those. Mm-hmm. So as an example, you don't have a robust traffic demand model in general use in any of the agencies, or certainly not regionally. And that may well happen in the next 5 years, let's say, such that it
I would actually argue that PAG has a fairly robust traffic demand model.
Well, I didn't mean the model. I meant the actual implementation.
Management strategy. Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
EDM strategy. It's the same acronym, but sorry.
Good point. But in any case, in order to implement it, we don't at this time know when that might happen or, you know, and what kind of an arc it might occur. But preparation for it is important. And so, you know, in some ways I could see us, you know, incorporating that goal into most new projects.
I do it now.
The current plan's got it as well. So the new construction is going to use the latest and greatest controller systems cabinets.
Just like safety is.
And we also have a categorical where we're working with the jurisdictions for many of those same technological upgrades, elements, purchases, whatever, that are going back off the main corridor systems into their other network. So
Chris,
we've got that in the current plan, and I would expect that would be a consideration going forward as well.
Crystal, do you mind pulling the slides back up? Because to Tom's point, we have 20 minutes left and we're kind of just getting into the meat. So, you know, where there's congestion, to me, what would be ideal would be like something related to, you know, having data, an ideal data set, which I don't want to go here, would be like, you know, condition of existing infrastructure as it relates to controllers or fiber connectivity. But I don't, we don't have that in a consistent way. We don't have that. But to me, that would be another piece that could make us feel a little bit more solid. So I think this is going to be potentially an interpretation of the congestion plus project level details. And that interpretation of the project description, I mean, I think that should be whatever. It's probably going to be staff. It's probably going to be me and Rick, like, stepping through that with the QC and follow up with other partners. But so that's kind of a tricky one, right? And so we're touching on some of the tricky ones. Provide safe, reliable, healthy, and efficient regional mobility. Safety. We have level of safety service. Again, it's also referenced elsewhere. Reliable, healthy, and efficient. You know, I think the healthy is not just safe. It is multimodal in nature. I think there are some other ones that more explicitly state multimodal capabilities. And so reliable and efficient are the ones that kind of, to me, or differentiate themselves from other goals. And a travel time index is a model output that kind of helps express if you typically have a 10-minute commute from your house to your kid's school, how often are you going to be able to drive that and be there in 10 minutes. So that gets at that reliability aspect. Efficient acknowledges congestion, you know, that it's not so this is kind of a tricky one. I would say travel time might be a good measure to address the reliable piece of this.
Hey, Josh, let's see if we can bring in Patricia and Ava.
Perfect. I've not seen their hands. I'm sorry.
I think both of them spoke about the healthy and you know, some of those characteristics of mobility and equity. And this might be a good spot to kind of talk about where you could see measuring you know, something like health.
Please.
Well, I wonder if this is about regional mobility. If this was also one of the ones under which, I'm not looking at the whole priorities list that we came up with right now, but I wonder if this is one of the ones in which we're trying to get out, allowing for more active transportation options.
Yeah, I think you're right.
So we wouldn't necessarily be talking about motorized travel here. We would be talking about being able to provide options that involved walking, cycling, body movement, etc., but that were also safe, right? That were also reliable, and that were also efficient. right? Because one of the things that we have right now is a bus route system where it takes people double or triple the amount of time to get someplace than it would in a car. Therefore, they're, you know, it impacts ridership.
Right.
Okay, good. So Josh, that sounds like something maybe you can work with as far as, you know, things that we already have in this database of, you know, will we have bicycle facilities, pedestrian, you know, is it a transit route, those kind of things that may give bonus points, if you will, to one project over another.
I agree. And so let, so if you don't mind, okay, Patricia, go for it.
I also just wanted to add like the presence of shade at bus stops and sort of just the user experience of each of these different options. I don't know what, you know, data we have on those sorts of things, but maybe that's on the ground data collection if that's possible to add in at any point. But
no, no, we're not gonna do that. I produce the tree canopy inventory for the region using our LIDAR data set in 2008 and have supported that exercise that has contributed to our green infrastructure. So we have good command of that tree canopy and the disparities of the distribution of it. So we have that. We can consider how to bring that in. As it relates to the multimodal components, there are a handful of other goals that touch on those. So that's where I was trying to like see what was kind of unique in this, but it's good hearing from the two of you about that perspective. So maybe if I can jump into the next ones.
Yeah.
So so we touched on the second slide where we're moving towards our sixth goal. So provide safer, more connected bike and pedestrian facilities, enhance health through active transportation options. So Ava, I think this one kind of speaks to your previous statement as well. And you know, there's a data layer that we can consider. Bike level of stress and pedestrian level of stress. And essentially it's an interpretation of the number of lanes and the volumes. And that, whether or not a facility, you know, those are two data points, how we incorporate those are something that we can consider. But I think that gets at, you know, basically, you know, kind of touching on these would be kind of two data points that I think could help make this more objective.
So the more cars and the more lanes, the higher the level of stress for both bikes and peds. Makes sense. Correct.
Yeah. And we in our safety plan, we have data demonstrating the level of safety of the different bike facility types. From bike lane based on our bike count program. And so looking at safety data and bike counts across different facility types, we have the data to demonstrate.
Sounds like that might really mitigate against widenings and larger corridor projects. Patricia, point?
I was just curious about that level of stress data. Like, is that based in place based on like actual reports of incidents in that particular location? Or is it based on like this general type of infrastructure is generally associated with this level of safety? Or like, I would just love to know a little bit more about how we achieve that level of stress like data point.
Right. Me too. And Patrick still hasn't joined. It's something that the city was able to implement, but there are dozens and dozens of examples. I just looked at one from Boston that, you know, kind of the key driving pieces are number of lanes and volumes, but there are other, you can get more sophisticated with that. We may not have the time to get super sophisticated, but I think we can have it as a really good proxy. to get at this, but this is a methodology that is used consistently by other regions and has been recently adopted in the Move Tucson, and I just couldn't pull up their explicit method prior to the meeting, but that's something that we can definitely dig into. Kevin?
Yeah, I was just wondering, I tend to doubt that it's available, but is there any data on, I don't know, like spot issues for bikes? I mean, I commute to work somewhat often, and I'm a confident cyclist. So, you know, I don't have any problem riding on, you know, 4 or 6 lane roads, as long as I have, you know, a shoulder. But then there's like certain areas like where we have, it's completely, I can't come up with the word, the through rights, with the pork chops. Tom, help me out here.
The right turn lanes that are
free right.
Free right. Okay. Yeah.
That's okay.
Like a free right. And then, so, you know, I'm cruising down the road and all of a sudden there's traffic coming more or less full speed right next to me on the other side.
Yeah.
So there's like spot issues there, and I doubt we have that data. Or, right. You know, would that be something that we could get? Or where are those locations where you have like certain situations where otherwise the corridors, in my opinion, for a confident cyclist is fine.
Right. And personally, I don't have that data. Like my team doesn't have that. That doesn't mean it's not something that could be worked on. I think it may be outside the scope of this exercise, but I think it is... It may very well be something that our jurisdictional partners are digging into, but I personally I'm not aware. I don't have that at our fingertips right now. Yeah. But I think that's again, this could be something that is potentially related to a categorical as well, because for the most part, the large named corridor projects are going to be paying attention to multimodal connectivity, safety, you know, transit, ITS components, and being able to have some of that.
I think you hit on it. It's probably like if it's a spot improvement type thing where otherwise things are pretty good, it's probably going to fall into some sort of categorical.
Yeah. And that may very well be like within a safety categorical context for vulnerable road users. Hey, Jonathan. You're muted.
Sorry about that. Hey, just thought I'd add really quick. So we've looked into this quite a bit in the county, and I think Patrick, if you were here, I can channel Patrick right now. I think the type of bicycle facility that may be for any RTA project, you know, a main roadway widening capacity project, can kind of get worked out in the details during design. And I don't think, at least for the named projects, we'll probably get into that kind of level of detail of deciding exactly what kind of facility, because there's a variety of things. In the past, we always just put like 6-foot paved shoulders alongside of arterial roads. But these days, both the county and city are now putting in what they call separated or protected bike lanes that have a buffer stripe between the travel lane and the bike lane. And that's a better, safer facility than just an on-street bike lane alone. And then beyond that, there's, you know, incremental ways you can spend more money and make those bike facilities even better. So I think with the categorical element, if there's a bicycle related category, that might be an appropriate time to kind of get into the nitty gritty of designing and thinking about those particular facilities. But at the name project level, I think that's too much, like you said, Josh, to get into kind of fine tuning the design, the appropriate design of that facility for the named projects. But I will just make a plug that there are ways to make bicycle facilities safer than just an on-street bike lane, and an off-street path or parallel multi-use path is one of those ways that can be kind of an all-ages approach to providing bicycle facilities for those that are not the quote confident riders like Kevin and myself and others. So it's a good thing to think about, but I think it's appropriate to think about, you know, what you can get accomplished right now and leave some of that designing effort to the project designs later on. So thank you.
Well, thanks for answering the call of jurisdictional partners on that. And I think with that those data points, that can be a meaningful addition of, hey, is this facility have a high stress level? That's something we can pay attention to. That may warrant a separated bike lane, or that may warrant it a parallel, you know, like I think that's a meaningful performance measure for that goal that gets outside of that adds to rather and doesn't like duplicate the safety component that is already reflected. I'm trying to think about, you know, how are some of these additive or, you know, can contribute instead of just multiply themselves. Patricia.
Hi, sorry. Yeah, this question, I mean, shows my lack of understanding of the engineering process, but just wondering, like, what safeguards we as the CAC have in, you know, the projects that we're prioritizing based on how, you know, safe we think they'll be for whatever type of multimodal, you know, person using them. Once they get into the design process, like, how can we know that they won't then be stripped away or become less safe or become, you know, less aligned with the goals that we've, like, I guess I just don't fully understand the timeline of how design happens. And like, once that this prioritization list is out of our hands, like, how can we be sure that it still lines up with what we thought it was going to?
Show up at every single meeting. Now, I don't know. I think it's a good question. I think being,
well, one thing is there, that right? Each project has a fairly detailed description. The named projects include a scope that the public is made aware of, and it actually drives the design that the jurisdiction is required to provide for that project. And in fact, it helps define what makes a significant change. Should a difference in the design criteria from what was provided to the public be contemplated, then it may have to go back to the voters if it's considered to be a significant change.
Yeah. And we have 6 minutes and like four more goals. I'm sorry, I didn't really manage this very well.
Make sure we at least see each of them, and just we won't have any questions to begin with, but give us all four of them.
This one is challenging.
Where you
improve
are?
Improve quality of air, water, wildlife habitat, and reduce greenhouse gas emissions and vehicle miles traveled. There's a lot to unpack there. So and so it's going to depend upon the interpretation of the project. And this may be one of those qualitative ones where we get the group to say, hey, how do you feel this project's going to address all of these issues? And it can be a low, medium, high impact sort of thing, or, you know, we need to kind of think about that. I did too many. And then the last set is, improve multimodal performance and access to key destinations, including but not limited to activity centers, workplaces, medical care, educational facilities, and grocery stores. I understand that there was extensive discussion. I observed it, heard it about this one. This one is also one of the trickier ones. The next one, add multimodal functionality to key corridors. So, you know, we have a couple of data sets on that, the regionally significant corridors plan that PAG produced, that was also referenced in the city's exercise as one of their data sets. High frequency transit network came out of a transportation plan, a transit plan that is fairly recent that was adopted. And then, you know, and then we may want to also consider the bike ped level of stress, you know, thinking about those multimodal functional, adding multimodal functionality to key corridors. So you know, where the key corridor could be that defined through that regionally significant. So those are some data points. We need to think about how that all goes together and turns into something meaningful, and then improve transit ridership. And, you know, there's a lot there, you know, and when, you know, initially a data set looking at that high frequency transit network, there's been a lot of discussion and thought put into where do they want to make those investments and how do we kind of move that forward so we can acknowledge that. That data set, along with regionally significant corridor, along with most of them, are available in the map in the legend. That bike ped level of stress would just be the one that we need to kind of pull together. As it relates to that top one, there would need to be a lot of work that goes into creating an activity cluster density map. We have a data set of all of the current employers, 19,000 current employer locations with the number of employees by NAICS code. So we could get there. That's a lot of work that may be outside of the scope of what we have, what we can accomplish in the upcoming weeks.
No, but at least on that one, if there's a key activity center somewhere on a corridor, it checks a box, especially if we're not landlocking them or, you know, taking them for, because of a widening or, you know, providing a signal where one doesn't exist today, those types of things. Seems like you can't just say, okay, there's a mom and pop, or sorry, there's a, you know, two person legal office somewhere on the corridor. And, you know, we're improving access to that because traffic will be better or there'll be a right turn lane or whatever it might be. I think that's way beyond really what the intent was here. I think key destinations as identified, you know, by the jurisdictions along each of these corridors is something that they can pull off pretty quick, I would think. And it might be something to ask them or for us to simply become aware of as we look at the projects.
And so that touches all of them. You know, there's still a decent amount of, work and questions to kind of still iron out. I know the timeline is challenging. You know, if we want to move, you know, this, so that, you know, that depends on interpretation of the project description is kind of a placeholder for that qualitative assessment. Do we want to have a collective kind of qualitative assessment of how well we think each project addresses these goals?
Well, I, for one, am kind of surprised that we don't have more, you know, of these that we don't really have a solid metric for. I'm pretty happily surprised, I think, that we'll have a lot of data available to us as we talk about those. And I also think that we're able to go through and fairly quickly check off, you know, success or no success on implementation of some of these goals. So, I don't know how everyone else feels about it, but it has kind of been a really good exercise for me to see that we have a lot of data. It crosses over into many of our different guidelines, but most of what we have there is either going to be something that we knew going in would be a qualitative discussion, or we actually have some proxy, if you will, for the actual guideline metric itself.
Now, these are the goals, because the goals were identified to be measurable.
Yep.
I didn't get into the principles, the guiding principles. I tried to.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I knew that.
Yeah, okay, but I'm just, I want to acknowledge, and I don't want to open this can of worms, but here I am at 401 opening this can of worms. These are the goals that were shared. And some of the equity discussions are associated with the principles.
Sorry to interrupt. I know that this has been a great discussion. I have to leave for a 4:30 appointment across town, so I apologize. But you guys want to continue to chat? Still available, but I you know, we are at the 4:00 end time. So I'll leave it up to you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to let you know that I do have to leave in about 2 minutes. If there's anything at all you need from me at this time.
Well, I know others will have to leave also. I think Patricia is on borrowed time here, and it's given us more time than she thought she would be able to. And we'll probably lose our quorum fairly quickly, but why don't we just keep chatting for at least another 5 or 10 minutes if people want to. Does that sound okay to everyone?
Works for me.
Okay. Thanks, Pocky.
Thank you, guys. See you later.
Thank you, Josh. I didn't ask you. That's probably the most important.
Yeah. So I similarly, Tom, once kind of got through it, there were really kind of a couple that we needed to maybe present that qualitative assessment on. And you know, considering that consensus, not consensus, but you know, getting the collective, the group thought on, you know, if we were to get everybody's individual assessment of it, that could be a way that kind of helps normalize it instead of it just, you know, I don't know. Like, honestly, I don't really know how to pull that off and incorporate it. I have some ideas, but if anybody else has them, I'd love to hear them.
Well, I don't see that those qualitative the qualitative goals that we've discussed today will necessarily show up in our database, but I think they can be a part of a decision matrix and can be certainly included in discussions about these projects, but to artificially give them a score, you know, without having specific data for them is probably not a reasonable
right hope. And I guess what I was thinking was, you know, for the however many we isolate, 3 or 4 or however many, was if we wanted to solicit CAC, the broader CAC group's input on it, we could, you know, kind of ask, frame the question of how well do you think this project, and I mean, this is not an insignificant ask, to look at the 108 or the 96 projects, or just the priority projects of, I forget what that number is, it's 65. How well do you think this project addresses this goal? It would have a no impact, a minor impact, or a significant impact sort of thing. To try to get it in the same scale of the other ones. You know, we can do that. I can have my team build that thing, and then we can have those survey results essentially from the group. But that's a bit of a lift.
Yeah, this sort of gets to Ava's two lists kind of a comment, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I'm wondering too if more is possible now that, you know, the TMC has given a good swipe and we have, you know, more priority projects that have floated to the top. that really allows us to, even if we break it down by jurisdiction, to talk about smaller groups of projects, definitely, and to be able to do more deep thinking and evaluating of them, okay, you know, in that way, you know, that having those more deep conversations about, well, where do we think in this smaller grouping, these projects kind of measure up against each other in terms of these different categories. Or, you know, goals, that's cool, and priorities.
I mean, that's definitely a strategy, and that would just have to be, we would have to get consensus and buy-in that any future exercises are gonna touch on these areas with that intent, and, you know, and leave room for that, provide space for that discussion.
Yeah, well, we've committed to not basing our decisions on unmeasurable goals, but that's different than considering whether these projects impact those or not, and that's a qualitative discussion point that does not, in my view, you know, rise to the level of necessarily a ranking exercise.
So am I,
but can still have that kind of you know, impact on individuals in the conversation.
So is there I mean, could we move forward with like trying to bring the data? I mean, I can get to the lists, but I guess the idea of maybe where some of these are more qualitative, those are going to be handled less in a scoring criteria and more through the dialogue and discussion.
Yeah, I think so. And I think some of them are kind of a go, no go, or, you know, pass fail type of a.
And to me, like, I think, like, okay, while it's not a small lift, it's not an insurmountable lift to like do that survey to and it's going to force our CAC members to like think about each project, you know?
Yeah. And it may also be that it's best utilized, you know, after we are able to pull off half of the projects that we know are solid that we want, and then, you know, really get more into these added conversation arguments, you know, as we get into those.
So what timing? Now you're talking about timing, and I and it sounds like we may have a portion of it ready first, and then, well, I guess that's what we're talking about. Just, I guess, to kind of a two-phase or maybe a three-phased approach of we apply the data for the objectivity component as best we can. We have another meeting to kind of iron that out. I can present to you as much information as I can to get you all comfortable with that. Then we potentially have a discussion about it in that sub area level discussion. Or plan C being not have it in that sub area discussion and wait for that smaller set of projects to then have the discussion.
Yeah, potentially.
Okay. All right. I think it whatever. I'm good either way.
Josh, we're making it up as we go too. So
yeah. Yeah.
I apologize for that, but that's just
no, it's all good. I get it.
Here.
I think it could be a healthy contribution to the dialogue on, you know, getting people to think about the projects.
Absolutely. And yeah. And people are going to want to say, are going to want to talk about each of the guidelines with respect to a project. It may be that the project, you know, satisfies a couple of guidelines or goals, obviously, because that's, you know, essentially what it was created for. But that doesn't mean that we don't acknowledge that it doesn't address other parts. It's important for us to understand that we're not going to have, as we've said many times, we're not going to have every guideline and goal satisfied by every project.
Right.
But we're going to have an overall project that is geographically balanced, that's modally balanced and regionally balanced. So we need to have, you know, the opportunity to bring some of those issues in as we're discussing individual projects.
Okay, that all sounds good. I think we're at a point where we need to kind of close down the conversation as we.
Yeah, we're done.
So I really appreciate everyone's time, and sorry if I didn't get us closer to where we needed to be talking sooner. So.
Maybe you had a goal that was,
I wanted to get here. I mean, this
was different than, you know, we were necessarily, all on the same page for.
No, I wanted to get here, but I felt like we kind of, the meat of what I thought we were going to be talking about was, condensed a little.
Yeah. Yeah, it was.
Sorry about that. All right.
No, not yours. That's on the chair.
All right.
We're hereby adjourned.
Perfect. Take care.
Thank you, Josh, very much. Yep.
Thanks very much. Appreciate it.
Bye.
Great job, guys.
Be good, everybody. Guys. Take care.
Thanks.
We'll see you.